All right, thanks everyone, and good afternoon. We're also listed on AIM, so we are a dual listed company, ASX and AIM. So I'll talk a little bit to this slide. There are a lot of slides, but I'm not going to talk to most of them because some of them are a bit more technically focused. I'll give you the overview, a little bit about where the company came from, what we've done in the last 3 years since we've been here on the North Slope of Alaska, and what's coming up. So we ostensibly started exploring in Alaska about 3 years ago, as I mentioned, and we were chasing an unconventional resource play with considerable scale. And this play was put together by our joint venture partner, who's based out of Houston, who led Conoco's charge into the Eagle Ford, where they have arguably the best acreage in the play. And I guess the more poignant aspect of that is that Conoco put together their position 2 years before the discovery well was drilled. So how did they do this? And it really was down to, at the time, a unique prospecting methodology or toolbox where you could identify the best parts of the shale, because shale is ubiquitous in these oil and gas basins. It's everywhere. However, finding the best part of the shale is, there's a little bit of a trick to it. And you know, we think we've got a little bit of a competitive advantage in relation to that. So we started off with about 10,000 acres 3 and a bit years ago. We expanded to 100, and now we have just under 500,000 acres. And this is really a testament to our confidence in the play as we've continued to evaluate the resource potential. So the North Slope of Alaska, it's a pretty oily place, home to Prudhoe Bay, the largest conventional oil pool in North America. Bisecting our acreage position is the Trans-Alaska Pipeline System. And the Dalton Highway, the pipeline can carry 2 million barrels of oil per day. Currently it's carrying about 500,000, so considerable capacity. And this is a byproduct of the fact that Prudhoe Bay has been around since the 70s, and it's now entering the kind of final phases of its life cycle. So what the Alaskan government did in order to encourage additional exploration is they put in place an incentive scheme, which we were able to take advantage of. And most of these pastely colours on the map are owned by independents who came in as a product of that incentive scheme, whereby you get up to 85% of your exploration dollar back in cash. So as a small company 3 years ago, much smaller than we are today, you know, this was a massive boon for us. And this is part of, I guess, the above ground story. So without the below ground story and the above ground story, it's very hard to make a project like this work. So you need both of the elements. And certainly we do have both of the elements in this project. So obviously I mentioned the infrastructure of the Dalton Highway. It's the only all year round operational access road getting to the North Slope of Alaska. It runs 800 miles down to Anchorage. So where the red and the blue, just down to the bottom of the map here, the blue part is operated by our joint venture partner, Burgundy, and the red part is operated by us with a 78% working interest. So the other things of note on the map, you'll see these green call-outs. One of them is Prudhoe Bay over here in the top right-hand corner. The other ones are all discoveries or oil fields in a new or relatively new conventional play in what's called the Brookian, which is a stratigraphic sequence on the North Slope here, which had been underexplored and drilled through quite a number of times, but really missed by a lot of the exploration drilling that had been done in the past. And this was because in Alaska you have, it's quite cold obviously, you have 1,300 feet of permanently frozen ground, and through which it's quite hard to get good resolution on seismic up until recently. Advances in 3D mean that you can now image very effectively through this permafrost. And as a result, we've seen a billion barrel discovery, which is the largest discovery onshore USA in a conventional oil field in 40 years. So that's relatively significant. And I think it was the fourth largest a couple of years ago globally. So that obviously tells you that there's a fair bit to come here in Alaska. And we also have significant conventional potential on top of the shale, the HRZ shale, the unconventional play that we're chasing. So this is, I guess, the corporate snapshot. Quite a lot of shares on issue, and this is a company that actually has been through several evolutions prior to several of the board members joining along with myself 3 years ago or 3.5 years ago when we put the new project in Alaska, which we've coined Project Icewine. market cap of around 140 million Australian dollars or 90 million pounds, and very good liquidity, and that's really a byproduct of a very strong retail shareholder base. So this recaps on some of the things I was mentioning when we looked at the map. So what we did, you know, following on from, I guess, this methodology that our joint venture partner had been so successful with Conoco and the Eagleford, is we put together the acreage. You know, he had spent many years trying to figure out where the best parts were, and then we drilled a core hole to try to confirm whether he had got it right. So we analysed that core data in the first half of 2016. And what we were really looking for were what we called at the time Achilles heels, things that without which the project cannot work but don't guarantee the success. So really they're the weaknesses in the project. Instead of going, oh, well, this is a thick shale and, you know, all these things, which are obviously important, we're really looking for the weaknesses that, you know, if you don't have one of these elements, it just cannot work. So, you know, the key ones of these were thermal maturity, because really the key to this toolbox is viscosity. So if you have a low viscosity fluid, it can flow at higher rates through the reservoir. And obviously you want that to be mostly oil because it sells at a higher price, and in Alaska there's currently no market for gas. So in order to get this low viscosity fluid, you have to be in this very small sweet spot in the thermal maturity window. So you have, you know, oil which cracks into gas, and then in between that you have gas condensate, and then you have a narrower band which is called volatile oil. So we needed to prove that that's what we had. So, you know, we analysed the core, and, you know, Paul Baczynski, the CEO president of Burgundy, turned out that his predictions were right and the years of work that he'd done had paid off. We also didn't have a very good handle on the permeability, which obviously is the cracks through, and in shales, the very tiny cracks through which the oil needs to be able to flow, and you obviously enhance these with fracture stimulation, and we were pleasantly surprised that it was much higher than our expectation. So they were probably the two key things that we de-risked through the core hole. And what that told us was we need to, you know, drill another well and actually execute a stimulation operation to see if we can get a flow rate. So that's what we did last year. We drilled a vertical well. We placed 1 million pounds of proppant and 28,000 gallons of water into the HRZ formation. And then we flow tested it for a number of months, and we got about halfway through the flow testing when it started to get cold in Alaska, and because we weren't flowing at a high enough rate of water through this permanently frozen ground, it was starting to freeze up. And if we'd had oil flowing through, it acts like antifreeze, and that would have meant we could continue testing. But as it was, we considered that it was prudent to take a break, suspend the well and come back, which we're going to do in April or May of this year, depending on the weather conditions. So concurrently to the two wells we've drilled in Icewine 1 and 2, the core hole and then the production test well, we've been shooting 2D seismic, which was initially a reconnaissance 2D, which really was, you know, large acreage position, but where will the prospectivity be? We didn't really know because there's not really a lot of exploration down in this area. And what we found was that there's quite a lot of prospectivity out to the west. And now we're going to, and we've been expanding acreage out that way because of that, and now we're on the cusp of shooting a 3D, and on the basis of that, we're quite confident we'll be able to secure a farm out in the second half of this year. And there has been some unsolicited interest. So both of these plays are extremely large in scale. There is an element of risk here, obviously, because it is exploration, but we're talking about multi-billion barrel potential on both the unconventional and the conventional play. So this is just a recap of Icewine 2, and then the cost at the bottom of what it will take to bring that back on and conclude the flow testing, so $1.5 million net to us. And this is a wellbore schematic using a coiled tubing unit and nitrogen injection to lower the hydrostatic head, which helps the natural pressure in the reservoir lift the, you know, 4 kilometres of water that's sitting in the casing up to the surface, and we need to get about 5,000 more barrels off the reservoir before we think we'll see some significant hydrocarbon cut, and that should take two weeks or so once we start. So this is a little bit of a recap. So when we first started this project, and this, I guess, is why this opportunity presented itself, because there was, I guess, a legacy view, and often you will see this in the oil and gas industry. Oh, that's been explored, there's nothing there anymore, or that's the wrong spot, or lots of other reasons why good ideas can't be good until they're proven that they are. So what I guess this acreage was, you know, it was perceived to be in a gas window, which obviously is useless in Alaska at the moment. The reservoir was considered too soft to frack because it does have a little bit of clay in it, and also that it was perceived to be normally pressured, and, you know, we now know that it's highly overpressured. We were able to execute a very effective frack job, and also we know that we're in the right hydrocarbon phase, being a low viscosity volatile oil phase. And then you can see, you know, this is just a schematic from Conoco's Eagleford acreage. You know, the lowest cost, highest rates, and the most profitable on their acreage. And that's kind of the methodology that we're trying to emulate. And this is, I guess, a recap also of some of the other things that we've, you know, analysed and shown to be working. And the upshot of all of this is that, you know, we now know that we have all the ingredients in place for this shale play to be successful. What we don't understand is how economic it will be, and also we can't guarantee that we're going to be the people that actually crack the nut on this, or whether we need to get outside help, you know, someone with deeper pockets and you know, a greater depth of operational and technical expertise. But what we think and we're confident of is that because we have this very compelling data set, is that we'll be able to attract someone that will partner with us and fund that for us moving forward. So this again is just another slide which runs through some of the things I've talked about in relation to what we've accomplished. We obviously need to get a bit more fluid off the reservoir, and there's a few other things where there are areas of uncertainty that we need to resolve as well, which we should be able to do with the testing of this next well. And this is, I guess, a bit more of a philosophical slide, which is probably better illustrated on this slide, which shows, you know, what we've done and where we are. We're kind of in the middle of where you need to be before, you know, you go into full field development, but we're in a very good spot. So moving along, this is more focused on the conventional potential. All the blobs are leads or prospects that we've mapped using the 2D, either that we acquired or we reprocessed some old 2D. And, you know, we have obviously, as I mentioned before, some very good potential out in the western area. And we're about to start acquisition of 500 square kilometres of 3D seismic. And that will cost net to us 6 to 8 million. And so basically what this slide is showing is that all the yellow part are sands that have been intersected in wells that we can now map on the reprocessed and reinterpreted seismic, which they wouldn't have been able to do back when, you know, that the original seismic and when these wells were drilled in the 90s or 80s. And what we can also see, the green blobs on the well log there are all the oil shows. And we see movable hydrocarbons in some of these historic wells. And now we can map where, you know, how big and extensive these features are. However, we need to have a higher degree of certainty before we go and drill a well. So that's why we're going to acquire the 3D seismic. But, you know, we see good reservoir quality, 17% porosity even in the deeper sections, and obviously there's lots of oil in Alaska, as we already discussed. Resource numbers, you know, almost 2 billion barrels gross, 1 billion barrels net. You know, by any standards, these are very large targets. And then these are slides that run through a number of the leads and prospects, which I won't go into any detail. It's probably more for the technically minded people out there, and I'm more of a commercial guy, so I'm not going to get into that. But what I guess this one's kind of interesting, and what it shows is that with the reinterpretation and reprocessing of the seismic using modern algorithms, we can now identify amplitude versus offset anomaly, which can be a direct hydrocarbon indicator. So this is encouraging. It's not definitive by any stretch of the imagination, but if we shoot the 3D and it confirms this, you know, this will form part of a, you know, a data set that we think, again, that we'll be able to attract a partner on. And again, similarly, by taking a slice out of the full stack AGC, we can now resolve, even on the reinterpreted data, where we see these sand packages, whereas when you look at the old data, you could not see these. And with the 3D, it will become, you know, much higher resolution. So this is, kind of work in progress, a recent acquisition, opportunistic kind of bottom of the cycle decision, but the oil price has moved on significantly since we made the acquisition in December. So it's a small parcel of acreage, but it has an historic discovery on it, which was discovered by BP in 94. And, you know, it looks quite compelling, but we are still quite early into this, and it's a work in progress, as I said. But I guess the key part is that up until 2016, there was no infrastructure out here to the east where you can see the Yukon Gold call out. But 2016, Exxon built a pipeline from Point Thompson to Badami, which is connected to the Trans-Alaska pipeline system. So now there actually is a much shorter path to market. And obviously, you know, we don't have access to that at the moment. We have to do a lot of work to prove up that there is a, you know, a commercially viable oil pool there based on, you know, probably another well and some 3D seismic. But this is, you know, this costs us just over $1 million for potentially 100 million barrel oil field. So that's pretty compelling metrics. And this obviously is a pretty busy slide published by the Department of Natural Resources in Alaska. And this kind of shows how busy it is on the North Slope at the moment. Five wells will be drilled just to the north of us on this new Brookian play that we're also chasing. And they've had something like 9 from 9 successes over the last 4 wells in this play. So we expect that, you know, at least a couple of those will be successful. And there is also a well being drilled up to the northeast, which is in a formation which it shares with our Yukon Gold discovery. And then just as a recap and summary, you know, what's coming up. We're reopening the Icewine 2 well to flow that back and hopefully get a decent hydrocarbon flow rate. And then on the conventional side, we're shooting 3D seismic. And then in the back half of the year, we hope to be able to execute 2 farm outs, which might be a little bit ambitious. But we do think we have a very compelling story. And then, you know, we're working up Yukon Gold to see if we can make a fist of that as well. And then in terms of the balance sheet, we have 11 million in cash versus a work program of 7 to 9 million. And we currently have $7 million worth of in the money options, which are due to expire within the next kind of 4 weeks. So we expect that most of those will come in because they're 50% in the money. And then finally, that cash rebate program that we took advantage of, we were able to lend against that. And we have a $16.5 million debt with Bank of America. And that's secured against $20 million of cash receivable from the state. So that's it. So happy to take any questions.
Yeah, just one question from me, actually, on the Project Icewine. You're saying here that that data is going to come through, that 3D seismic data is going to be coming through this month.
No, we're starting to acquire it this month.
You're starting to acquire it.
45 days.
When will you be able to make your appraisals?
Take 45 days to acquire and then 6 months to process and interpret.
All right. Do we have any questions from the floor then? Yes, a gentleman here on the left. Microphone's coming to you, sir. Thank you.
On the exploration refunds from the state, I mean, you've got the $21 million receivable there. So how timely and smooth has that process been working?
Well, up until recently, it has been very timely and smooth. I mean, Alaska has $90 billion in funds under management, making it one of the most cash-rich states in the US. However, because of the oil price drop in the last 3 years, they've been eking out and kicking the can down the road in terms of the timing of the repayments. So we had expected for those to be repaid last year, and we prepaid 2 years worth of interest with Bank of America in anticipation of that. And that hasn't turned out to be the case. So I suspect that, you know, they will pay out maybe a third this year, a third next year, and a third the year after. But it's a bit of a guess. They've got about $1 billion in total outstanding credits owed to oil and gas companies. But I think at some point in time, you know, they can't keep kicking the can down the road because there is reputational risk, and they are trying to continue to attract oil and gas investment in the state. So they need to honour, you know, their policy. But there's no risk of default or anything because, as I said, they've got, you know, $90 billion or so in funds under management.
Raise your hand if you have a question. Yes, yes, sir.
You mentioned that you have more than 4 billion shares. Did you ever thought about to do a reverse split?
I think about it, but not for very long. I mean, The longer answer, which is less flippant, is that, you know, for a small oil and gas company, and we're effectively valued like an option. So, I mean, what is the value? It's very hard to actually define it. The market obviously tells us one thing, but I can tell you that statistically, companies that are in our position that undertake consolidations will result in at least a 15% haircut to shareholders. So would I tear up 15% of the value of the company just to reduce the number of shares on issue? No, I would not do that.
Any other questions, please? Well, I've got a question for you. Talking about no infrastructure being in place up until parts of 2016 in Alaska, that new pipeline that's gone in now, you talked about metrics for that. Just how significant will that change be for your company?
Well, I mean, for us, that's kind of a part of that new story I was talking about, which is
a game changer.
No, I wouldn't say that. I mean, it's a work in progress, so I'd say it's too early. I mean, the infrastructure that's more relevant for us is the stuff that, you know, bisects our main project, which is the project Icewine acreage. You know, the Yukon Gold is, you know, it's more of an opportunistic thing. Maybe it will become a more significant part of the story in the future, but at the moment, you know, it's still work in progress.
That's part of your long-term plan then?
Yeah, I mean, it's basically, you know, you need to have a plan A, a plan B, C, D, etc., and this is probably plan D, I would call it.
Okay.
Yeah.
Any further questions for David before he goes? Right, well, if I can ask you to thank him very much. David Ward, please.
Thank you.